That sounds, whoa. That organ sounds a lot better in person, doesn't it? Thank you, Bev, for a great prelude this morning. I want to welcome all of you to worship on this third Sunday of Pentecost, and a warm greeting to those of you who are visiting with us. And a reminder, if you haven't already, to please fill out the attendance card so that we know that you were here and communed with us. I want to welcome everybody who is online as well. We will continue to have that wonderful option available for those of you who are remaining home for the time being. Just a few announcements. Immediately after our worship service at 11 o'clock, we will take a break. We will reconvene for our second half annual meeting. You will need this agenda, which is out on the table. If you don't have one already, you can get one at that time. It should be a brief meeting, but it's important that you stick around, voting members, so we have a quorum and that you might have any questions to ask as well during that time. I want to extend our prayers and sympathies for Bonnie Nigro, and she's a sister of Bev McCollum. Prayers for their family on the death of Bonnie's husband, Tony. So sympathies to you, Bev, and to your family on the death of your brother-in-law. Also, a prayer request for Michelle Miller, who's one of our members, and Gloria Miller, Michelle's daughter, was recently diagnosed with, and I have permission to share this with you, with cancer. So she's going to be on the prayer list for friends and loved ones of Morningstar, but please continue to, we ask for your prayers during this time for that young lady. At this time, the Reverend Dr. Damon Laker. June is the green envelope for Grace Reads, and it's a wonderful outreach project in South Omaha, and I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Laker.
Good morning. Thank you for taking a few moments to hear about this special program that we do called Grace Reads. I'm Pastor Damon Laker. I'm pastor at Grace Lutheran. We have this wonderful relationship with Liberty Elementary, where we read 9 months of the year, school year, to second and third graders. So recently, for second grade, read this wonderful book called If You Had T-Rex Teeth. Children find great joy in that. Coming up here in a couple weeks, I will be reading Flat Stanley to the third graders or second graders as well. For our third graders, we read this book here, Back to School Fright from the Black Lagoon, and coming up here in May, we'll be reading Jingle Dancer. We purchase all these books from Scholastic. Typically, our purchase runs for each of the months. We purchase about 130 books for the third grade and about 125 books for the second grade classrooms. We then give each of the children the book as we've read it, and that way they begin to have a little reading library at home. We thank you for your consideration and for your possibilities of supporting this wonderful ministry called Grace Reads as we provide educational resources to our children at Liberty Elementary School. Be blessed. Thanks.
Our outreach team was looking to expand our opportunities here in Omaha, and one of the suggestions was to partner with some of our ELCA congregations in South Omaha. So I want to say thank you to Pastor Damon, even though he can't hear me, but he might online. Really appreciate the opportunity to participate in that great outreach event. As we prepare our hearts and minds for worship, I invite the congregation who is here to please stand as you're able as we begin with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin together. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God and Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen.
Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Upon the mountain with my Lord.
God, you are the tree of life, offering shelter to all the world. Graft us into yourself and nurture our growth, that we may bear your truth and love to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Be seated, please. Our first reading is from the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of a cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of its young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain, on the mountain height of Israel. I will plant it in order that it may produce boughs and bear fruit and become a noble cedar. Under it every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest winged creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree and make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken. I will accomplish it. This is the word of the Lord. Shall spread abroad like a cedar of Lebanon. The righteous shall spread abroad like a cedar of Lebanon. It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, O Most High, to herald your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, on the psaltery and on the lyre, and to the melody of the harp. For you have made me glad by your acts, O Lord, and I shout for joy because of the works of your hands.
The righteous shall spread abroad like a
righteous shall flourish like a palm tree, and shall spread abroad like a cedar of Lebanon. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They shall be green and succulent, that they may show how upright the Lord is, my rock, in whom there is no injustice. Second reading is from 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter. So we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God, and if we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. This is the word of the Lord. Gospel according to St. Mark, the fourth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground, would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." Many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Congregation to be seated, please, and I invite any children who are with us online to join me here as I share with you something very interesting, and maybe those of you who are in our congregation here today know what this is. Anybody want to take a guess? What?
Avocado?
I wish. Mustard? No, but that's a great guess given our text today. This is an oak tree. It's a bur oak tree, and there are dozens of them that ended up in our landscaping in our front yard because the acorns have been distributed by some little rascal. And I'm not going to kill it, I promise you, I won't kill it. But I wanted to show you something very interesting about this oak tree. We'll replant it. But on the bottom here, you see what? The acorn. And what's the acorn doing? It's spreading out. It's taking root. And it's quite fascinating to watch this happen because I know the tree that it comes from. And the tree that it comes from is well over 10 years old. It's a beautiful oak tree. And this is one of its seeds. And so if we let this go, and actually we're going to try to continue to grow this, and I'm going to give it to someone in Cedar Rapids because they had that storm that went through, and hopefully we can plant a tree in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. But it reminds me of our text today when Jesus talks about the mustard seed, the tiniest of all seeds, and it's as if someone planted a mustard seed and that mustard seed grows into a humongous tree, a huge bush that spreads, goes wildly crazy if you don't control it. And Jesus compares that to God's kingdom, that God's kingdom continues to grow and that all it takes is that little seed. And what I want to remind our children and our families is that each one of us, when we were baptized, we became like this little branch on a tree that continues to grow. But we're also kind of like the seed, that when we're planted wherever we happen to be, maybe some little rascal plants us somewhere where you wouldn't expect to be planted, and you continue to grow through God's love, through God's grace, your roots continue to grow, and that creates this massive tree. And I think that's a beautiful illustration for the kingdom of God and for each of us who are part of God's kingdom together. And let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks that you give us the story of the seed today, that you have planted each of us in this world. You planted our youth and our children who are with us. Help us to know that through that seed we have awesome power to spread your love and your grace in this world. Continue to take root in us so that we might branch out for, with your love for others. In your name we pray. Amen. There we go. That one will pop up in a second. But I invite you to take a gander at the picture here on the screen. And what is it that you notice? It's pretty obvious, isn't it? It's a rock that once was, there it goes, a big rock, right? And at some point, a seed decided to land inside of the rock somehow. It's a mystery. We don't quite know how. And it looks like some sort of pine tree decided not only to grow inside the rock, but to really take root underneath the rock, outcropping from the front of the rock, and it's doing just fine, isn't it? What amazes me about this picture is that looks as if though the tree has some sort of crazy power over the rock itself. And for me personally, I think it's impressive when we look around our world and perhaps we see things that grow or take place in places that we least expect it. Like this oak tree that was growing in our front landscaping. But how likely is it that an impenetrable rock like this one on our screen could become shelter or even perhaps fertile ground for a tree like this? I don't think the odds are that great. But for whatever reason, perhaps it is a mystery. The seed took root and life grew out of a situation where it was least expected. And so I think as we look at this picture that God is reminding us in the midst of situations like this, that whether it's in nature or whether it's in Scripture itself, that God's kingdom is not only possible, but that it can take root and grow in some of the least expected places in our lives and in some of the most mysterious of ways. It's always fascinating to me how Jesus chooses to use parables in order to teach about the kingdom of God. And his analogy of comparing this tiny mustard seed to the vastness of God's kingdom does not disappoint us today from Mark's gospel. And I think the analogy itself asks us to use our imaginations, to use our experience in life, to wonder how this tiny little seed could take root and eventually harbor shelter for birds and for animals. How could a tiny thing this small have such amazing power? I sometimes wonder about Jesus. Why wouldn't he just compare the kingdom to something a bit more impressive, perhaps more robust, like Ezekiel's cedar tree that we hear about in our Old Testament story, the cedar tree on the lofty heights of a mountain? Why not describe the kingdom something like a giant sequoia? Its height and its age is unparalleled on planet Earth. But instead, Jesus shares these parables and we get something we didn't expect. Mystery and surprise of something that starts out so tiny. But it's not just the seed is tiny that makes this such a powerful and surprising story about the kingdom, or an example of the kingdom. Remember the mustard plants at least in the ancient Near East, as Jesus was meeting with his disciples, they would have known exactly what this was. Mustard plants weren't exactly the kind of tree or shrub that you'd want in the front landscaping of your yard, is it? And these tiny seeds, the seed that was on that person's finger, gave way to an unwieldy plant known for its obnoxious spreading. John Dominic Crossan, theologian, just comments on the mustard tree, the mustard seed, by saying, this is what Jesus said the kingdom was like, a pungent shrub with dangerous takeover properties, he says. Something you would want in only small and carefully controlled doses, that is, if you could even control it to begin with. And so it's not just that the seed is so tiny, but rather it's that it becomes so surprisingly powerful. It becomes an unmanageable beast of a plant. Jesus shares the example of the mustard seed because it eventually grows out of control. So much so that I wonder if we hear Jesus' parable again today and hear it as good news or bad. I wonder if it's good news or bad because personally I detest weeds and plants that grow rogue in my yard. I planted more than one kind of perennial in recent years that I've later regretted and had to dig it out or grab the Roundup. There's nothing worse than something that grows out of my control. It's disappointing when what seemed like such a good idea at the time has grown into something unwieldy and uncontrollable. Of course, I'm not just speaking about plants, am I? We don't like losing control over much of anything in our lives, period, do we? And if we're honest with ourselves, losing control or not having control over things in our daily lives generally isn't a warm and fuzzy feeling. It's not a welcomed thing in our daily lives. Some of us might try our very best to appear as if we're all put together, to give the impression that everything is under control, that we have the world by its tail. And then something might happen in our lives that shakes our foundation of who we are. We might wonder how we're going to dig ourselves out of that hole, whatever hole it might be. Maybe there was a time when you were like that robust boulder in the picture, but then you realize you've been broken and now you're being destabilized by some seed that's growing out of control right in the very heart of who you are. At first, the root system seems crippling, like you're no longer settled on the foundation of the ground below, beneath your feet. Then you realize something important. You realize that that root system has spread out, and now it's the only thing that supports you. The thing that's propping you up is what has taken root in, through, and underneath your very being. And no longer do you feel like you have control. It's the tree or whatever situation it is. It's in control, not you. But as people of faith, we realize there's one more important revelation. That it wasn't the seed that created that crack. It wasn't the seed that created the brokenness in the rock of your very being. That brokenness was already there to begin with. It was a seed that just happened to land, perhaps by fortune, in that cavernous space in your life to begin its very work. And so is this really all that bad? Or is there something good happening? Jesus says that the mustard seed is like the kingdom of God. And if that root system happens to be part of the kingdom of God,
planted within you in baptism and is taking root, I think, in some pretty surprising and uncontrollable ways in your life. And I think we have our answer, whether this is good news or whether it's bad. And yet, we might still wonder how that root system, this so-called kingdom of God, which began its journey as a seed, continues to grow in your heart and continues to prop you up in your life. I came across this story a couple weeks ago and I thought it was pretty cool. There was a professor at a small college who once gave a balloon to every single one of the students in that school, who were then asked to inflate the balloon and then on the outside of the balloon to write their name on that balloon and throw it carelessly into the hallway. That's what this illustration is, a bunch of balloons in a hallway. And then all the other professors came and they mixed up the balloons. And the students, in turn, were given 5 minutes to find their own balloon. You had to find your own balloon. You can imagine a hectic, frantic, crazy search in that hallway. No one was able to discover their balloon in time. So it was at that point that the professors told the students to just simply relax. Take the very first balloon that you find. And then hand that balloon to the person whose name is on that balloon. Within 5 minutes, as the story goes, everyone had their own balloon. The professor used this as an illustration to talk about happiness, and he says, these balloons are like happiness. We will never find it if everyone is looking for their own. But if we care about other people's happiness, we'll find ours as well. I hear the story and I hear something more than just happiness. The lesson, I think, is about experiencing a greater and perhaps more uncontrollable reality in our lives handed to us in the mystery of God's kingdom. That is, maybe the balloons that we hand to our neighbors are nothing less than a tiny part or a tiny seed of God's kingdom with their name written all over it. Perhaps the professor's lesson is about the power that we have in community that we call the body of Christ, in both the planting of the seeds and the growing of the roots, the sharing of God's love, and trusting as we say those words in the Lord's Prayer, that thy kingdom will come, and that thy will be done beyond our attempts to control it. I think we concentrate as people of faith, as citizens of this culture, so much these days on our own personal happiness, our own ideas of personal success, our own salvation. But could it be that in the process of focusing so much on ourselves that we actually miss something that's greater, the greater but mysterious good news of God's growing and spreading kingdom in our hearts and in our world? Could it be that true peace is found, true salvation is found in this world to the extent to which we see one another not as broken, sinful people, but rather as special, beautiful vessels of God's kingdom? For me, this is the gift that we have as the church, as a congregation together. A place of grace that accepts us the way Christ sees us, who chooses to take root in the very heart of who we are, who sees us as broken, yes, but beloved rocks, where God's surprising love has chosen to cultivate its roots, propping us up unconditionally wherever we find ourselves. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks that you shared the story of the mustard seed with us today. You remind us of how vast your kingdom is, that in the midst of our attempts to control things in our own lives, that the kingdom continues to spread. Help us to see ourselves as those seeds, that root system of your love for this world. In your name we pray. Amen. Please join me as we confess our faith together through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us come before the triune God now in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, you plant the seeds of faith in every nation. Enliven your church so that the good news of your grace may take root and grow throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator, even the trees, the shrubs, and the flowers delight in your goodness. From the depths of the soil to the highest mountain, bring forth new plants. Restore growth to places suffering drought. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Judge of nations, we pray for our leaders, those in power. Grant them the ability to regard those under their charge with humility, dedicating their lives in service to others.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Divine Comforter, you show compassion to those in need and provide relief to those who call upon you. Bless all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit this day. We lift up to you Gerald and Don, Ken, Virginie, Eunice, Lowell, Lindsay. We lift up to you Alexandria. We pray for those who are in the midst of grief, for Bonnie Nigro and for Bev, for their family. And Lord, we lift up to you those loved ones that we hold now in our own hearts. Take root inside of them, that they may know of your healing power. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sovereign God, this place of worship belongs to you. We give thanks and pray for our church musicians this day. We dedicate to you the joyful noise that comes from this place, the cries of children, the melody of voice and instruments, the songs from our hearts. We celebrate the gift of coming back to gather again in person. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, we give thanks for our ancestors in the faith who are now at home with you. And we look forward to that day when we are reunited in your new creation. Lord, in your mercy, we lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting now in your abiding grace. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you, as you're comfortable, to share God's peace with one another. Continue now with our music offering. Be seated, please.
Our humble, thankful hearts.
Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us now in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body and for the life of the world. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
The Lord was on high in the
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As we gather for worship, we gather around the Lord's table, which has been prepared for you and for all people. I invite you at this time to take the elements that you have in your pews and to receive the promises and presence of Christ this day. Be seated, please. Invite the congregation to please stand as you're able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. And now the blessing of God, who provides for us, who feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forevermore. Amen. Peace, and remember that you are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God. We'll take a brief break, and please join us again for our annual meeting in about 2 minutes.